Let's everybody grab a seat so we can get started. Thank you. Morning, everyone. Opening scripture this morning is coming from Psalm 84, 1 and 2. Psalm 84, 1 and 2. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. Let's pray. Your Father in heaven, we thank you for this day you've given for us. We thank you for the blessings that you've given to us. Thank you for the sunshine, and we also thank you for the rain. Father, we pray that you would be with us as we go through this service, that you would bless it and help it be in accordance with your will. Father, we pray that you would strengthen us, guide us, and also forgive us of our sins, because we are human and we do fail. Father, we pray that we may do the things today that be pleasing in your sight. Christ in our prayer. Amen. First song this morning is number 23, and no, it's not Angry Words. That's what it was in the old book. This is the 728B in the old book. Let's stand for this song, please. There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight. Each day disguised in heavenly hue and framed the world with his great might. There is a God.
Upon a tree,
I don't know about you, but the singing sounded pretty good up here. All right, number 712. Probably should have just said stay. Trouble sometimes I hear, failing men's hearts are to fear.
Gems for his crown.
wanted to mark your songbook, 869, that'll be the song after the lesson, 869. Now let's stand one more time. I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then the light from heaven filled my soul. It made my heart in love and wrote my name above, and just a little talk with Jesus made me whole.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell about our troubles.
He will hear
our faintest cry. Find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Sometimes my past seems drear without the ray of cheer, and then God found behind the light of day. The mist of sin may rise and hide the starry sky, but just a little talk with Jesus clears the way. Have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry. Answer by and by.
When you
feel a prayerful yearning,
as your heart
and hand is turning,
you will
find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Makes it right.
I may have doubts and fears, my eyes been filled with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. I go to him in prayer, he knows my every care, and just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry. Answer by and by.
Can you
feel a little prayer for yearning?
Heart
and hand is turning,
you will
find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
It makes it right.
Please be seated. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh man, I'll tell you. Things did not go the way I planned last night. Got the sermon done, got the bulletin done. Well, let me back up about half an hour. Thunder, you remember the thunderstorm that kind of rolled through here yesterday?
Yeah.
We lost power for about 3 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
Just long enough for my computer to lose its brains. That was the start of it. Then I got everything finished finally, and I went to print. And I was out of 8.5 by 11 paper. So I went to print the bulletin. And my printer, for some reason, will not print on the ledger size paper unless there's 8.5 by 11 in it. That makes absolutely no sense to me. I don't understand it. Had I designed it, I would have designed it differently, but that's the way it was. So I took some old printed stuff that was laying around, put it in the 8.5 by 11 thing, and pushed it in and printed the copy of the bulletin for Marie to proof. So if there's any mistakes in it, it's her fault.
Well, we already knew that.
But got it done. It's in your hands. It's in God's hands, too. So, and it's, but it's the 19th of September already? We're going on vacation in a month. For 2 weeks. And then it's hunting season. Oh, I'm old
moves forward. It's amazing. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for blessing us with another day, giving us this time that we can gather, that we can sing these great songs, songs of praise and worship and encouragement. Father, we pray that our singing has been a blessing to us and to you. And Father, we pray that as we continue, as we start to study your word, that we can focus on your word and its meaning and how it applies to our lives, the importance of what we read. Father, most of all, we thank you for your son, Jesus, and his life, and everything that he has done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So we've been studying John's gospel now since January of 2020. So it's been a little more than a year and a half. We're getting there. John's gospel is an interesting book. Now, the main purpose of the book isn't stated until you get almost to the end. You read all these anecdotes of the life of Jesus, and how he interacts with others, and how he teaches his disciples. You read about all the details of his last day alive and his crucifixion. And you read about the amazing details of the day that he rose from the dead. But you don't get to know the purpose of John's gospel until you've read all of that. It's like John wants to give you all the information and let you start forming your own opinions about what he wrote. And then he tells you, oh, by the way, I wrote all this so you would believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and so that you can have eternal life. But there's so much more that I didn't write. Starting in chapter 13, we read about Jesus with his disciples during their last meal together, what we call the Last Supper. John includes so much more detail about Jesus' teachings during the meal, but no real details about the meal itself. At the end of chapter 14, Jesus says, "Rise, let us go from here." And that leads me to believe that they actually left the upper room where they were sharing the meal and started walking toward the Garden of Gethsemane, which is east of the city of Jerusalem, a little bit up on the Mount of Olives. Chapters 15 and 16 include more of Jesus' teachings. And if I'm right about the end of chapter 14, these teachings are during the walk from the upper room to the temple area, which is on the highest hill on the east side of the city of Jerusalem. Then in chapter 17, Jesus prays for the upcoming events of the day. He also prays for his disciples, the 11 that were there with him, and the people who will believe in him because of them all the way through history until the end of history. Chapter 18 begins after the prayer. And with the beginning of chapter 18, John shares the details of Jesus' last day. John 18, verse 1. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the brook Kidron, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. After Jesus finished his prayer, they left the city of Jerusalem proper, heading east. They crossed what the English Standard Version calls the brook Kidron. Technically, Kidron isn't a brook. It's what in the south they call a run, or in the Middle East they call it a wadi. It's during normal seasons, it's just kind of a trickle. But in the rainy season, there's a huge flow of water. So the Kidron flows down the valley between the Mount of Olives and Mount Moriah, where the temple was. The Kidron Valley is also where all the, shall we say, fluids left over from the sacrifices at the temple went. There were two gates on the east side of the city. Both of them were near the temple. There's the southeast gate, which, I mean, the name kind of describes where it is. And there's a stairway going down from that gate into the depths of the Kidron Valley. It's really deep at that point. And then there's the golden or the Shushan gate, which has a more gradual decline down to the Wadi and then back up the Mount of Olives. This, in my mind, is probably the gate that Jesus had come through during what we call the triumphal entry, only a few days earlier. Now, Jesus and his disciples walked from there up to the garden on the west side of the Mount of Olives, on the Mount of Olives. No, it is the west side of the Mount of Olives. I'll get my directions right here in a second. In fact, the garden was probably a walled olive grove. We call it the Garden of Gethsemane, and the word Gethsemane is actually derived from the Aramaic word meaning oil press. It housed a press for making olive oil. Let's take a look at Luke 21, verse 37. And I got my slides out of order. Luke 21, 37. And every day he was teaching in the temple, but at night he went out and lodged on the mount called Olivet. And according to Luke, Jesus would spend his nights in the olive garden, and probably his disciples with him. So as they're leaving the city, probably late at night, after their final meal together, it wouldn't seem odd or unusual for them to go east toward the Mount of Olives and climb a short way up the mountain to this olive grove and then bed down for the night. Probably more than just the 12 disciples knew where Jesus spent his time. I would imagine that any of his close followers would have known where he spent his time. Mary, Martha, and Lazarus lived only a few miles away in Bethany. They probably knew he stayed there as well. So Judas, being a member of Jesus' inner circle, one of the 12, would have known about the garden and would have probably known the location of the garden where Jesus would spend his time. John 18, verses 2 and 3. So this is not going well. There we go. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers, sounds like he went out and bought them. Having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there to the garden with lanterns and torches and weapons. There are some interesting historical details that support these verses, or at least the general information that's there. The Romans took over the area around Jerusalem in about 63 BC. But the Jews were allowed to keep limited autonomy. The Romans had set up a local resident of noble birth who was loyal to Rome as the king over the area, although he had limited authority. And that was Herod the Great, by the way. When Rome got fed up with how this king was running things, his power was taken away and the Roman province of Judea was established. That happened around 6 AD or so, and included both Judea and Samaria in the one province. And some of what used to be the kingdom of Edom was south and east. There was also a Roman governor assigned to carry out the wishes of Rome in the area. And at this point in time, that would be Pontius Pilate, who we will see later. But now, there was a third and more important level of, shall we say, rule in Judea, and that was the high priest and the Sanhedrin. the high court that met in the temple. Rome knew that the high priest was an influential position to the people of Judea. So they did their best to control who was in that position. Even though when God established the high priesthood, the position was intended to be a lifetime appointment. So Rome also understood the religious festivals of the Jews, or at least they understood that during these times, Jerusalem would become extremely busy and overrun with Jews. And when you're trying to control a population, it's much more complicated when there is a large number of them in one place. So during the major festivals, Rome would move a large contingent of soldiers to Jerusalem for crowd control. Passover was one of those times, since in the law it says that all Jewish men were required to be at the temple for Passover. Now these soldiers would be housed in the Antonia Fortress, which is built just outside the north wall of the temple grounds. But the temple had its own guards and gatekeepers. According to 1 Chronicles, David organized the Levites into groups of workers, musicians, and guards. These guards were used to protect the temple and also were there if the Sanhedrin, for any reason, needed support. Now back to the text. Judas had two different groups of people supporting him as he headed off to the garden on the Mount of Olives. He had a group of temple guards from the Sanhedrin, and there was also a Roman contingent there. But we're not sure how many of them there were. Like I said, Rome would send a large group of soldiers to Jerusalem for the festivals as crowd control. So these Roman soldiers were probably from among that group. Verse 4. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said, "Whom do you seek?" John's version of the encounter between Jesus and Judas in the garden is different from all the other Gospels. John doesn't tell us that Judas identified Jesus with a kiss. Jesus approaches the crowd that is looking for him and asks them who they're looking for. Now, remember how intimidating this crowd is. Judas had a, quote, band of soldiers and some of the temple guards. Now, the Greek word that's translated as band could be anywhere from a dozen to 600 soldiers. It was probably on the lower end of that, but the Romans wanted to make sure that there was no uprising in Judea. So their show of force wasn't just for show. And the chief priests in the Sanhedrin believed that there would be they were looking for. Verses 5 and 6. They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. I love these two verses. They demonstrate the power that Jesus has. But it's not as impressive in English as it is in the Greek. When the group looking to arrest Jesus told him who they were looking for, Jesus identified himself. But he did it in a way that most people miss reading an English translation of the Bible. In English, Jesus replies, "I am he," simply identifying himself as Jesus of Nazareth, the man that they were looking for. But in the Greek, Jesus replies to them, "I am," identifying himself as God, who was and is and will be. He used the words that God spoke to Moses on the mountain from the burning bush. And notice what the crowd does when Jesus identifies himself. Again, there are more nuances in the Greek. In English, it says that they drew back and fell to the ground. In the Greek, the word used for fell usually implies an unintentional act. They were not in control of what happened. It just happened. It's sometimes used to describe what happens to you when you trip over something. It's also used in Revelation chapter 1 to describe how John reacted when he saw the vision of Jesus. And he says, "I fell at his feet as though dead." These battle-hardened soldiers of the most powerful empire on earth simply fell flat on their faces when Jesus spoke the name that was only spoken by the priests in the temple when blessing the nation of Israel or during sacrifices. Jesus revealed his true identity and provided just a small glimpse of his power. Verses 7 through 9. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fill the word that he had spoken of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one. Verses, in John 10, verse 11, John shares another of Jesus' I am statements where he says, "I am the good shepherd." The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Everyone in the garden that night knew how dangerous the situation was. The temple guards, the Roman soldiers, and Judas, the betrayer, all trying to find Jesus of Nazareth so that he could be brought before the high priest and the Sanhedrin and charged with blasphemy. But Jesus had just proven that he hadn't been blaspheming because he identified himself with the name of God that was given to Moses, and all those looking at him fell on their faces before him. And the Romans didn't care about blasphemy, they just wanted to keep the peace. Jesus told them that he was the one they were looking for and that they should let the 11 go. Now, Jesus had just prayed in the middle of chapter 17 that he had not lost one of the ones God had given him, except for Judas. Jesus protected his disciples like the good shepherd that he was. He stood between them and the wolves, looking to take them in. But things didn't work out quite the way that they wanted them to. And honestly, Peter would be out of character if he didn't do something rash, right? Verses 10 and 11. Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" Peter had a sword. Well, honestly, it was probably more of a long knife or a really short sword. the Greek word that's translated as sword here is a generic word, but it's generally used for a long knife used for sacrificing or for preparing food. This could have been the knife that he used to prepare fish, being a fisherman, but that's just me guessing. But Peter, according to his character, did something rash. Jesus had the situation under control, but Peter felt that he needed to help Jesus. Both he and Thomas earlier had said that they were willing to die for Jesus, or with Jesus, if it came down to that. And the other, Simon, in the 11, was known as a zealot, which was, that group was considered to be terrorists by the Romans. Somehow, Peter rushed the group and swung a sword and hit Malchus, the servant of the high priest. Now, unless Peter was trying to cut his head off, which would have been difficult with a short-bladed sword, I cannot figure out how he ended up cutting off Malchus's ear, his right ear. But that's what happened. And as usual, after Peter did something rash, Jesus berated him for his actions and his failure to actually apprehend the situation. Peter didn't get it. But Jesus was ready to do what the Father had set out for him to do. Luke gives us a slightly different description of this little skirmish. It's in Luke 22, starting in verse 49. And when those who were around him saw what would follow, they said, "Lord, shall we strike with the sword?" And one of them struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this." And he touched his ear and healed him. Now, just a few verses earlier here in Luke, Jesus told them that if anyone didn't have a sword, they should sell their cloak and buy one. The disciples pointed out that there were two swords among them. And Jesus said that was enough. Evidently, they only needed the one. Then here in verses 49 through 51, when the crowd came to arrest Jesus, Peter attacked the servant of the high priest, whom John tells us is named Malchus, and cut off his right ear. And that's when Jesus stepped in and stopped the fighting. But he did more than that. He healed Malchus. Maybe that's another reason why the group left the 11 alone when they took Jesus into custody. Some, or at least one of them, had tried to fight back against the arrest, but Jesus went willingly. He was in control of the situation. He was not controlled by the situation. Back in John 18, verses 12 through 14. So the band of soldiers and their captain and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jews that it would be expedient that one man should die for the people. This may give us a little more insight into the size of the group of the Roman soldiers, or possibly the importance of keeping the peace for the Romans during the Feast of Passover or any of the other major religious feast days. Since there are so many Jews who came to Jerusalem for these religious feasts, there was likely a very large contingent of Roman soldiers being housed in the Antonia Fortress. The Greek word here in verse 12, that is translated as captain, is actually the Greek word that is used to describe a Roman tribune. Now, I don't know if you know about Roman rank structure in the military, but a Roman tribune was generally over a extremely large number of soldiers. commander of 1,000. Now, maybe the force accompanying Judas was made up of the tribune and his centurions. There's really no way of knowing how big the force of the Romans that were there to ensure the peace when Jesus was apprehended, but they were there. Once Jesus had been bound, he was taken to the home of Annas, the father-in-law of Caiaphas. Now, both of them in John are called high priest, which just serves to point out the confused mess the temple was in due to the Roman control. Like I said earlier, God set up the role of high priest as a lifetime appointment. But the Romans wanted someone in that position who was influential to the Jews but was compliant to Rome. Annas did fit that description for a time. But after a while, he started pushing back against the Roman governor, so he was replaced. First with one of his sons, and then another one, and then eventually with Caiaphas, his daughter's husband. Now, Caiaphas was high priest, at least in name, for 16 years. But the people in the Sanhedrin still looked to Annas as the high priest, as God had intended. Good or bad, high priest is high priest for life. So now the temple guards are probably the ones bringing Jesus before Annas. The Romans, they don't really care about this religious stuff that the Jews are dealing with, so this has become more of an internal issue since the arrest was accomplished relatively peacefully. The statement of Caiaphas was about to prove to be prophetic. John, and that comes from John 11, verses 49 and 50. But one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish." And he was right. Jesus would die for the people, but not just the Jews, for all people. Jesus was on his way to becoming the sacrifice that God had planned him to be since the beginning. He was about to become the sacrificial Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. John makes sure that he demonstrates fully that Jesus is the Christ. The story of Jesus being arrested demonstrates that in a way that is completely unexpected. You see, the Jews expected a Messiah who would take on the Romans and kick them out of Jerusalem. One who would establish his kingdom and rule the world from a throne in Jerusalem. But that's not the Messiah that John shows us. He shows us Jesus' power. When Jesus identifies himself to the group that Judas brought to the garden, he shows his power. They couldn't stand in his presence. They fell on their faces before him. But Jesus demonstrated his power also by willfully going with them to be tried and eventually crucified, even though he was innocent. He had done nothing wrong. In fact, he had never sinned. He was the perfect sacrifice. The lamb without blemish that would be sacrificed for the sins of the world. The disciples didn't completely understand it. They knew he was the Messiah, but they were stuck on this earthly kingdom. Peter even tried to defend Jesus in the garden by attacking the servant of the high priest, as if the Son of God needed Peter's help to defend him. Jesus is the one who stands up for us. He knows what it's like to be human because is he was tempted just like we are. And he didn't sin. Because he didn't sin, he became the perfect sacrifice to cover our sins. For a sacrifice to be effective, you have to accept that that sacrifice is for you. You need to identify yourself with the sacrifice that Jesus made for all of us. You can't just say, Jesus is my Lord and Savior, and think that that's it. You have to live like he is your Lord and Savior. You have to give up your will to him and obey what he teaches. And that requires a sacrifice of your own. Paul wrote to the congregations in Rome that we need to die like Christ died. We need to be buried with him by being baptized into his death, and that frees us from our life of sin so that we can be dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus. If you want to know more about that, or if you have some problems that we can help you with, come and talk to me. Let's stand together.
Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And thus around the throne, and thus around the throne, we're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion.
Jesus is standing in Pilate's hall, friendless, forsaken, betrayed by all. Hearken what beat in the
Did anyone get missed? Does everyone have? If you'll ask me to lead thoughts around the table this morning, and after that sermon, I don't really know what I was thinking of saying. Would have much, would probably detract on the sermon. But Phil said a couple of things. I just want to at least touch me. That account of in the garden showed the power of Jesus when the soldiers kneeled. We see the power of Jesus 2,000 years later when we do this. It's so powerful that we're willing to immediately make adjustments and adapt to new ways of doing this when, for health reasons, our old way of doing it forced us to make changes, but also we had to adapt to some political and policy changes as well. So, and you know, when I stand up here, I've said this before, I find this packaging to be a bit silly or not, just seem in keeping with the actual Passover feast. So I have to get past this package. But the power of Jesus is we are willing to do whatever we need to do to ensure. And here we are 2,000 years later, making sure that we take communion together. The second thing Bill said was that Peter acted rashly and had to be berated by Jesus. I can definitely relate to that. And he actually brought some physical harm to another human in his rashness. The only way that could be resolved was through the healing power of Jesus. It all just sort of comes together, is what this is all about. So let's pray as we think about Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, and as we take the bread. Father in heaven, thank you so much. We are able to meet together as one body and in unison. Focus on your son's sacrifice. The lessons we've heard in the last 2 years have just been amazing, Father. And we thank you that we've been able to refocus on that. And it's not always easy to understand how this all works. It's not always easy to get it. So often we don't. But we thank you, Father, that his sacrifice does cover our sins and our failures and does heal us. We think now specifically of his body that was broken on the cross. We have this piece of bread to remind us of that. We do this weekly so that we never forget or just take for granted. Forgive us of our sins. Thank you so much. We pray through his name. Amen. Father in heaven, now we come before you and we think of his blood that was shed on the cross, that washes away our sins. Father, we know sometimes we do need to be disciplined and learn lessons from our sins. It's hard to take sometimes, Father, but we also know, Father, that the blood that was shed does wash these sins away and brings healing power to our lives. Help us, Father, to, again, not take that for granted, but to use this time to be ever so mindful of that and to continue to strive to be better, and be better ambassadors of your Son. It's through his name we pray.
Number 669. It'll be the last song we sing this morning, at least during service anyway. We'll sing, you got the set up, right? We're going to sing all three verses first, and then we'll sing the chorus afterwards, okay? Hopefully I'll remember that. Best laid intentions, right?
Take my life and let it be consecrated.
No longer mine.
Father in heaven, again, we come to you in prayer, and we pray that this time that we take up this collection, that you will be honored, and that our hearts will be in the correct place. And we just ask for your guidance as well when it comes time to utilize these funds for the work here. Pray through your Son's name.
Today, after we're done Bible study, if you feel so inclined, we will have hamburgers and hot dogs downstairs to share, and hopefully people brought side dishes as well, so it's other than just hamburgers and hot dogs and buns. And then after that, we will hang around and have a game afternoon. So we'll play some games. That's after Bible study. There is a work day scheduled for Saturday, this coming Saturday, the 25th, starting at 9 o'clock. So if you can, please plan to come out and help out. And then next Sunday is potluck. So bring food to share. You'd think that we just focus on eating here. Just timing. So again, next Sunday is potluck, so please plan for that as well. I got a card in the mail the other day. It's got an elephant on the front. And it is from Noel and Jessica Stafford, the Kilimanjaro Missions. I'll read it, but then I'll post it on the back as well. Thank you so much for your warm welcome toward our family. We enjoyed fellowshipping with all of you. More so, thank you so much for your contribution toward our upcoming mission work. Thanks to you and others like you, all our one-time expenses have been covered. We are now applying for future contributions toward our monthly support. Please keep us in your prayers. In him, Noel and Jessica Stafford. See. Any other announcements? And I'm looking at Paula.
Paula's mind is running. I just wanted to say that I got a call from Ashley, and she wanted to change the September work day. But then I talked to Dottie, and we decided to continue with the October workday, and then set one for September workday, and then set one for October when the Staffords can be there.
And also, if you want and are available Sunday after potluck, we can hang around and continue to work as well, because Marie has some stuff she needs to get done on the building as well. So, we are very willing to help anybody who wants to work on the building. Trust me. Yes. Closing scripture comes from Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. And I'm not going to sing it. I have been crucified with Christ. And it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live, in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for for sending your Son as a sacrifice for our sins. We pray that we can be in Him, that we can do your will, that we can live a life that reflects your love, and that we can obey you and do what's right. Father, we pray for those who are mourning. We pray for those who are traveling. We pray for those who are sick, fighting cancer, just dealing with difficulties in their lives. We just pray for strength and courage and wisdom and healing. Father, we pray that you will continue to bless us as you have, that you will help us to do what's right with the blessings that you give to us. Father, we pray that we will forgive those who annoy us and do things against us the way that you forgive us, because you know we fail. Father, we pray for your protection from harm and from the evil one, and that you will guide us to do all that you have planned for us. In Jesus' name.